William Morrow and Harper Audio present The Life We Chose. William Big Billy D'Elia and the Last Secrets of America's Most Powerful Mafia Family by Matt Birkbeck. Read by Jason Culp. For my dad, who is always with me. The impossible we could fix right away. Miracles take a day or two. Russell Bufalino. Prologue. It was a late afternoon in October 2006 when a black Lincoln town car pulled in front of the modest house on a hill in Hughestown, a borough in northeast Pennsylvania, midway between Scranton and Wilkes-Barre. The driver, a tall, middle-aged man with jet-black hair, was about to open his door when a car abruptly pulled in behind him, blue lights flashing. He looked into the rearview mirror. Behind the blue lights were more vehicles, their lights also flashing. Closing in ahead of him were even more cars and SUVs, filling the normally tranquil street in front of his home. Above was a loud whirring noise, and he peered up through the front windshield to see a Chinook helicopter overhead. Within seconds, his car was surrounded by frantic men and women, some in uniform, others wearing windbreakers emblazoned with FBI, Secret Service, and Homeland Security. All had their guns drawn and pointed at him. They screamed out directives to put his hands up and to slowly get out of the car. It was all happening so fast, with near military precision, but he knew the drill. "Here we go again," he mumbled to himself. 5.5 years earlier, on May 31st, 2001, the FBI, U.S. Secret Service, Pennsylvania State Police, Internal Revenue Service, and U.S. Postal Inspection Service had all raided the same home. He had just driven away, but was pulled over on a local road. When they searched his car then, they found several guns in the trunk, including an AK-47 and a shotgun. In the back seat was a suitcase, and inside was a MAC-10 submachine gun. A 9mm Beretta was holstered to his side. Now, on this late fall afternoon, and with the sun already setting, he was again surrounded by an overwhelming show of law enforcement officers and agents. But this time, they included the Department of Homeland Security, Border Patrol, and Immigration and Customs Enforcement. Free on bail from an earlier money laundering charge, he wasn't carrying any weapons. But he did have $38,000 in cash in his inside breast pocket, money he had just collected from a Russian in Hazleton, Pennsylvania. As he slowly emerged from the car and into the cacophony of chaos and noise, he could decipher the loud, nervous repetitions of "hands above your head" and "we'll blow your fucking head off." One young agent, pointing a gun at him, couldn't keep his hand from shaking. "Easy with that," he said. He turned around and was shoved against the car, searched, handcuffed, placed inside an FBI vehicle, and then taken to the local magistrate and charged with trying to hire a hitman to kill a witness in his money laundering case. After, he was transported to the Lackawanna County Prison in Scranton. His stay there was short but pleasant, given all the food, mostly Italian delicacies and desserts, that had been sent to his cell courtesy of friends, local businesses, and restaurants. His jailers didn't mind. Many knew him personally. A few days later, he was transferred to the prison in neighboring Pike County, which borders New York State and New Jersey. It was there, without warning, he was roused from his cell, shackled, and escorted out of the back of the prison and into the rear of an unmarked FBI SUV. Within minutes, a long procession of unmarked law enforcement vehicles sped west along Interstate 84. It looked like a presidential motorcade, but that didn't stop an overzealous state police highway trooper from flagging down the lead vehicle, which he had clocked going over 90 miles per hour. When the trooper approached, the driver opened his window and confidently flashed his badge and FBI credential. "License and registration, sir," said the trooper. The FBI agent, a bit flummoxed, held his identification higher. FBI, transporting a prisoner to the federal courthouse in Scranton, he said. The trooper remained undaunted. License and registration, sir. FBI, said the agent, now a bit agitated. We're transporting a prisoner to the federal courthouse in Scranton. I don't care, license and registration, the trooper repeated. He peered into the rear of the truck and immediately recognized the large figure in an orange jumpsuit seated on the passenger side. The trooper's eyes grew wide. Is that Billy D'Elia? He said, gawking. Yes, said the FBI agent. Well, why didn't you tell me you had Big Billy in here? Then go through. William Big Billy D'Elia was the most sought-after organized crime leader in the United States, who had for years been on the radar of federal, state, and local law enforcement agencies. He was known as the mob's negotiator, the guy who was summoned to settle problems, or make them go away. New York, Philadelphia, Kansas City, Los Angeles. Wherever there was trouble, the call went out to Big Billy. But he was more than just the mob's fixer. Billy was mafia royalty, the so-called son of Russell Bufalino, who was arguably the most powerful and important organized crime figure of the 20th century. Billy had spent nearly 30 years at Bufalino's side, from the mid-1960s until Bufalino's death in 1994, and subsequently became the unquestioned leader of the Bufalino family. Now that he was finally in custody, law enforcement agencies throughout the country were eager to talk with him. Almost every week, Billy was transported from the Pike County Prison to the William J. Neelan Federal Building and U.S. Courthouse in Scranton to meet with one investigator after another. There were the detectives from New York City assigned to the FBI/NYPD Joint Terrorism Task Force, who quizzed him about money laundering operations based in the Bronx that allegedly wired tens of millions to Middle Eastern terrorists. Another group of detectives from New York's Organized Crime Task Force sought information on decades' worth of mafia activity there with a focus on the hierarchy of the five families, while Philadelphia detectives were keenly interested in Billy's firsthand knowledge of their city's once powerful and violent crime family, which had been through two bloody wars. More FBI agents arrived, looking for information on mafia families in Chicago, Kansas City, Los Angeles, and elsewhere, while the Secret Service wanted to know about counterfeit money operations throughout the country. New Jersey investigators wanted to hear about his ties to illegal gambling and money laundering operations in Atlantic City, which had banned Billy from entering the city in 2003. And in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, the state capital, Billy was subpoenaed to testify before a grand jury investigating a longtime friend, a Scranton billionaire, who was suspected of lying about his mob ties to gain approval for a casino license. Every week, there was someone or something new to discuss. And, of course, there was Jimmy Hoffa. That first trip to the Scranton Federal Courthouse, the one interrupted by a state trooper, was to bring Billy face-to-face with two FBI agents from Detroit who were part of a new unit assembled to investigate the 1975 disappearance of the former Teamsters leader. Though Billy was never a suspect himself, Russell Bufalino was among the handful of men the FBI strongly believed had taken part in Hoffa's disappearance and alleged murder. Frank Sheeran, a Bufalino subordinate and Billy confidant, was another suspect, and the FBI was convinced they both had shared details with Billy about their involvement. They must have, the agents reasoned, given how close Billy had been to both men. But when the federal agents announced their intentions, Billy brushed them off, saying only that Hoffa was not on the farm, a reference to a field in Michigan where investigators were searching for the former Teamsters boss's remains. The dejected agents flew back to Detroit empty-handed, much like every other federal agent, investigator, detective, and prosecutor who came to speak to Billy then and over the ensuing years. But Billy did have a story to tell. He was just waiting for the right time to share it. Chapter 1. Pittston. Blood, brains, and bone were all that was left of Snowball's little furry white head. Just a few weeks old, the puppy had been playfully prancing in the backyard with the boy. It was a gift from a neighbor who had won too many puppies. When he came by the house to deliver the dog, he delighted the little boy, who held him to his chest and immediately knew what he'd name him. It was just a couple of days later that the boy took Snowball outside, and the white puppy romped from one side of the backyard to the other. But then he wandered among the soon-to-be ripe tomato plants way in the rear, and the boy watched in horror as a brick suddenly came crashing down on the puppy's head with such force it killed him instantly. The boy ran to the dead animal and fell to his knees in a state of grief and shock that only a 4-year-old could feel. Teary-eyed, he looked up to his father, who was still holding the brick, which dripped red puppy blood and dark brain matter. The father took pride in his garden, and he didn't appreciate anything, including a puppy, disturbing his tomato plants. "You wanted a dog. Now clean him up," he said. The boy, whom everyone called Billy, followed his father's command and put the dead pet, along with its brains, into a bag. His father, William P. D'Elia, was a plumber by trade, but his day job was driving a rig for the city of Pittston's fire department. He worked a 4-days-on schedule, with his 3 days off split between earning extra cash with the odd plumbing job and drinking beers at Viola's Bar, his personal refuge on Main Street. When his father-in-law died, William P.'s wife, Teresa, knew to call him there. "Pa died," she cried. "What are you calling me for?" he shouted. "Call the undertaker." William P. was the son of Italian immigrants. They had arrived in Pittston around the turn of the century via the same route over the vast ocean that had led many others before them to this little town on the banks of the Susquehanna River in northeast Pennsylvania. It was pretty there, the river slicing through the mountains, which were painted green during the summer and with brilliant brown hues during the fall. Dozens of communities sprouted up along the river's banks from Scranton south to Wilkes-Barre after anthracite coal was discovered in the late 1700s, tons of it. The communities had names such as Port Griffith, which was 8 miles downriver from Scranton, and Exeter and Kingston, which were just across from Wilkes-Barre. By the late 1800s, Pittston had become a central coal hub. The brittle black rock mined and shipped through its canals down to Philadelphia and even farther, into Baltimore. Italian immigrants had come in such droves, they eased out the Scots and Irish working the mines and took control of them. Mining jobs in Pittston were plentiful. An underground river of anthracite called the Big Vein stretched through the entire town and under the Susquehanna River into West Pittston. Several mining companies worked the rich vein, much of which was virtually free of impurities. That made the black rock even more valuable. But the work was incredibly dangerous, and injury and death were a way of life. One early morning in June 1896, the roof of the red ash vein of the Twin Shaft Mine caved in, killing 75 of the 100 men and boys who were working there, 400 feet underground. Their bodies were never recovered. In 1905, 7 miners working the Clear Spring Coal Company's shaft in West Pittston ended their shift and boarded a cage meant to carry them to the surface. As they were hoisted up, the cable broke and the men plummeted 200 terrifying feet to their deaths. Rescuers found only body parts. Despite the dangers, Pittston became one of several final landing spots for the thousands of Italian immigrants who sailed into New York but didn't want to stay in the crowded city. Many traveled even farther west and settled in places like Detroit, Pittsburgh, and Buffalo, while others went no farther than Pittston. Some families even split up, with some members staying in Pittston while brothers, sisters, parents, and cousins continued the journey. Geography didn't matter for Italian immigrants. For them, blood ties were everything, not your location. The D'Elias lived in a white house on Wilford Street, which wasn't far from the river. Single-family homes with small front gardens and white picket fences lined the street. After his arrival from Italy, Billy's grandfather had worked underground in the mines for several years, but later avoided the drudgery and early death that went with mining when he became the waymaster for the Pennsylvania Coal Company. His favorite activity was sitting on his front porch every Thursday afternoon, slicing up vegetables and fruits from his brother-in-law's grocery store. They were too old to sell, but too fresh to throw out. So he cut up.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.